Well, today we're continuing a series. I kind of had to pause last week as we worked through things last week, but we're continuing this series on the body and honoring God with our body. And I just remind you that in all the years that I've preached, I've never preached on this, and I don't know that I've ever heard other pastors talk too much about this. We talk about our mind, we talk about loving God with all of our heart, and we talk about all these other things, but we don't talk about loving God with our bodies. It's almost like we've been more influenced by a Greek thought of the way our human beings are put together than a biblical Hebrew mindset. You know, in the Greeks, they believed that whatever you did with your body really didn't matter because it was your soul, it was your spirit that lived forever. So that's all that mattered. So it wasn't like whatever we did with our body really doesn't matter. And interestingly, if you go back to Greece even today, that thought played out will lead to such terrible immorality in all different kinds of places. What we do with our body does matter. Biblical mindset is that we are whole beings. In a Hebrew or biblical mindset, they would never tear a person apart, like, and say what you do with your spirit is worse or better than what you do with your body. Like, we want to love God with everything that we have. We want to give God everything that we have. And a big part of that would be loving God and honoring God with the body that He gave us. Because, again, what happens if our body breaks down and we're not able to do what God has called us to do? Then there's so much that's missed. Even our legacy could be missed in that. We want to be healthy enough to do whatever He wants. So I want to remind you of 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20 is our key verse for key verses for this entire theme. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? Not a home. A home is a place where somebody lives, but a temple is a place where God is worshiped. The Holy Spirit lives within us, and our bodies are temples where the Holy Spirit can be and should be worshiped from there. Who is in you, whom you received from God. You are not your own. You are bought at a price, the life of Jesus Christ. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. We want to honor Him with everything that's within us. So that's the key verse. How do we honor God with our bodies? The first scripture that we dealt with is the mastery principle. It's in 1 Corinthians, the same chapter, same thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12, the second half, says, I have the right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything. So in this, He's just saying, just take a look at your life. If there's anything that has mastery over you, look at your routines, look at the things that are going on in your life. It's like, I have to have this. That's a very dangerous place to be in. And you know, just no matter what's going on in our life, we are to enjoy everything that God has given us, but not be mastered by anything, which would include chocolate mousse tracks, by the way. You know, I just want to, I'm here with you. Like, enjoy it, be thankful for it, but when it becomes an addiction, we need to know that begins to destroy us. That if something, you have to have something, what you're basically saying is, I cannot do what God wants me to do because I have to have this. And it's become on the throne of our life. So we're looking at our lives and saying, is there anything in my life that has mastery over me? And like getting rid of it. Is there anything that I've wanted to do and just cannot do it because it seems like something's got a pull on me, something's got a mastery on me? I love preaching this at the very end of January. Did anybody make any New Year's resolutions? And how are you doing on those? Seriously, how are you doing on those New Year's resolutions? And because if you made up your mind that it was something that God wanted you to do, and and you found that 1 month later, things aren't going too well with that, then you really would come to the conclusion, something's keeping me from doing what God wants me to do. That's probably got a mastery over me. I need you to admit that to somebody, get some accountability, get some help on that, and then it's time to go where God leads us. So today I want to go back to the Old Testament, to one of the Ten Commandments, because in the Ten Commandments, there is a scriptural principle that deals with taking care of our bodies that I believe is more ignored today than at any point in history, and just want to deal with it. In Exodus chapter 20, there's something interesting about the Ten Commandments. Have you ever seen those little signs that they put up this is all the Ten Commandments? And like some of them, it says, like, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal. Those are one lines. But do you know there's a couple of the Ten Commandments that go on and on and on and on? This is one of them. Exodus chapter 20, 8, 9, 10, and 11. So there's more verses on this command than any of the other Ten Commandments. It is a big deal. It says, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. That word holy means it's set apart. It's not just like every other day. It is a completely different day than any other day. Now he's boiling it down even more. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Now, sometimes we mess up on this commandment because some people aren't working at all. Part of this is that we shall work. We were made to work. We were made to do things. We were made to fulfill God's commandments on earth. So 6 days, you shall work. And it's important to work. But the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord. On it, now he's boiling it down. On it, you shall not do any work. Neither you nor your son or daughter. Wouldn't that be great? Like, hey, it's Sabbath day. Can you clean the house? No, not you, not your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For, now that word for describes why or the basis behind it. For in 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Now let's pause there for a second. Whenever you see a scripture go back to creation, where it goes back to even before the fall of humans, when it goes back to that before, it's like this is set not in the commandments, it's set not in the law. This is a principle that's set in creation. This is when God made us, this principle was alive in this. So it goes back to that. He rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy, made it set apart. So what do we find in this? That we shall work. We're supposed to work. We're supposed to work for 6 days. That's big. The seventh day is set apart to God. It's a Sabbath to him. We also find in dealing with this Sabbath principle that like every 7 years, different things happened. There's crop rotations that happened in it. That one part of how God made us is he made us to work, but he made us to rest. And rest is a key part of health. Now let's move on. There's another one that deals with this in Exodus chapter 34. In Exodus 34, this boils it down a little bit better. 6 days you shall labor, but on the seventh day you shall rest. Even during the plowing season and the harvest, you must rest. Why would he put that in there? I think, after they got, well, this is our busy season. This, and in every single trade there is a busy season. And it's important that during those busy seasons that we apply this principle. Let's imagine your busy season goes on for like 7 weeks. And it's really hard for 7 weeks. Do you know what I believe that you need to do in that? Schedule, going right into it, knowing the next 7 weeks are going to be incredibly busy, we're going to schedule a time of rest right out of that for our family to reconnect, for me just to rest. Because in the middle of that, what we find is that God created us to rest. And relationships cannot be made at high speed, at Mach 2. We've got to have some downtime in order for our relationships to grow, in order for our body to replenish and recuperate. Now, one more scripture that deals with this that we really need to hear. This is from the New Testament. There's a time when Jesus was, it was a Sabbath day, and Jesus healed somebody on the Sabbath. Do you remember that? And of course, everybody's like looking at him and going, ah, lawbreaker, he's broken the Sabbath, you know. Jesus begins to teach on that. And so Mark chapter 2, verse 27, then he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. You know what he's saying in that? He's like, this is a principle that will benefit you. This is not a principle that, like, you do this and God will love you more if you do this. It's not like if you, like, break the Sabbath that, like, God's going to come down and strike you down because you've broken the Sabbath. It's because Sabbath rest rejuvenates us. It is the Creator talking to us and saying, this is the way to treat your bodies. This is the way to treat your relationships. You need this so much. I don't know, has anybody ever bought a new car? And I don't know, are there people in here that when you buy a new car, you read through the owner's manual from front to back? Is there anybody like, no, I don't even look at the owner's manual until one of those little red lights comes on in the car. And like when the red light comes on in the car, oh, what's that? And you kind of, okay, you go through the owner's manual and try to figure out what's going on with it. Perhaps you got a new car and the way you treat it is based on what others have taught you in the past. Like this is what you should do. So let's just do one of the most basic things with a car. One of the most basic things is you buy a new car. How many of you think you probably need to change the oil at some point in a new car? Okay? People have different philosophies on changing the oil. Do we have anybody in here that's like, we're like our entire life, we're strict, 3,000 miles, we change the oil no matter what, every 3,000 miles. Is there anybody got that going? Some of you were going like, well, that was what we did 20 years ago. The oils have changed, and now, because the oils are better, that, you know, some go like, I've heard 6,000, some up to 10,000 miles. But is there anybody that says, you know what, like, I just change our oil about every 50,000 miles. Is there anybody? What do you think would happen? Do you think your car would break down at 20,000 miles if you didn't change the oil? Probably not. Probably would keep going. You may not even notice, may not notice something. I don't know. I'm not a mechanic on that. But what do we know for sure? If you change your oil regularly, like if you change the oil 3,000, 5,000, 7,000 miles, if you do that, your car's probably going to do pretty well on that. If you look at your car and say, like, I'm just going to change my oil every 25,000 miles, what do you think's going to happen to your car? You know this, it is going to break down before it should have. That's just the principle. It's not going to go like it was designed to go. It's not going to be everything that it was meant to be. And so you could ignore it. Every one of us in here has been like, I want to change my oil every 3,000 miles, and like, oops, now it went farther. Every one of us has messed up and done that. But if you do it repeatedly and repeatedly and repeatedly, your car is going to break down. Friends, this body is exactly the same way. God designed us to work hard. A key principle, like if you don't work your heart's not going to go as long as it's supposed to go. That's a part of this working out and the working for 6 days. Now, people have studied this and they found out, you know, we at least need to 3 times a week get our heart rate up for 20 minutes and get it working hard for 20 minutes. Please see a doctor if you're trying this for the first time. Don't want you to say, Pastor told me to do this, but we're supposed to work. We're supposed to work. But a key part of it is we're supposed to rest as well. And it's work and rest going back and forth that keeps a body going strong and healthy. You know, the Centers for Disease Control have said that there is a new epidemic that's facing our country that's different than ever before, and it's called sleeplessness. That we're finding that people are like going to bed, but they're not sleeping. There's all kinds of reasons for that. It's a very dangerous thing. There are people that are just not going to bed, not sleeping. They're not sleeping what they should be. You know, we want to know some guidelines for that. Guidelines for adults that kind of think about the oil change scenario. Adults need to be resting regularly between 7 and 8 hours a night. Doesn't say you need to be resting 12 hours. you're not supposed to sleep your life away. There's a lot of proverbs about that. It's like, you know, like you begin to love sleep and you're going to lose your life in that way. So we're not to sleep 12 hours, but we're supposed to sleep between 7 and 8 hours as an adult. If you're a teenager, do you know what it is? Your teenager goes, like 6 hours, right? No. If you're a teenager, it's between 9 and 10 and a half hours of sleep that you're needed. Like, this is the way our bodies work. If you're a little kid, you need regularly, if you're like a school-age kid, you need regularly over 10 hours all the time. It's got to be routine. And you know what? Kids don't decide this. Parents decide this. Parents, be a parent. Get your kids to bed on time. They need that. It is very, very important. In fact, I would say that one of the best parenting tips, you know, with 6 kids, we've learned a few things on this. I'd say one of the best possible things that you can do as a parent is establish routine for your kids' lives. They need routine. They've got to have routine. You can break away from routine, but they really, really need routine. And what we're finding is, like, not do kids need routine. Everybody needs routine. So, the Centers for Disease Control says that with sleeplessness comes all kinds of things. You're more likely to die in a car accident. Isn't that likely? You're more likely to get fired because you're sleeping on your job. You know, that kind of thing. But there's all kinds of things like diabetes and high blood pressure and even cancer that's been found to be related to not sleeping well, not sleeping in good patterns. What the Centers for Disease Control say is that people need to establish a bedtime and go to bed at exactly the same time. Do you know, if you try this, if you go to bed at the same time for about a week, and if you get up at the same time, like set your alarm, to go to bed, set an alarm, and to get up and set an alarm. Do you know after about a week, your body will wake up like a minute before your alarm? It is an amazing kind of body that we have. That if you get into this routine, your body wakes up rested. And if you're living off an alarm, it should set off an alarm in our minds. If an alarm has to wake you up regularly, then something is going on in our lives that shouldn't. Not only is it like go to bed at a certain time and wake up at a certain time a very good thing, but the hours that you go to bed and wake up are just as crucial. Can I tell you a little wise thing from my grandpa years ago? Like this is literally written in stone at our house. early to bed, early to rise. It makes a man healthy, wealthy, strong, and wise. you know, they just kept pounding that in. And you go, well, that's just a myth. That's just, you know what? The Centers for Disease Control say that we've got these patterns where, and you felt it. Have you ever felt like in the middle of the afternoon, it's like, oh, like you're all of a sudden down, and then you feel refreshed at another point in the day? Do you know your body's cycles? If you learn your body's cycles and go to sleep or go to bed when your body is at one of those low cycles, then you just go into sleep really well. If you miss that cycle, then you're trying to force your body to go to sleep at a time when it's more difficult to go to sleep. They've actually found and studied this. Your body clock may be a little different than others, but between 10 and 10:30 at night, there's a thing like our bodies just begin to go down and we get to this low point, and it's a natural place to just build in a routine to get ready for bed and be going in when that happens. You know what you begin to do? You go into that sleep, and it's a great, great thing for rejuvenation. Do you have that kind of pattern? Some of you might say, well, yeah, I go to sleep every night, 10:30, on the couch. And then you fall asleep, and then you wake up, and you have to go upstairs and the whole routine and all that, and you've interrupted it. Just begin to, this is not elbowing anybody else. This is just you looking at you and saying, am I violating rest? Am I working with sleep in my life? Is it a problem? Many people have found, have you ever heard of the siesta? I remember when we went on a mission trip down to Belize. When we were down there, it's like everybody stayed up really late, but man, in the middle of the afternoon, like everybody's asleep again. They found that a little nap is incredibly vital in a person's life. Now, when I say a little nap, if that nap goes beyond a half hour, it's not a nap. You've gone to bed, you know. Like a half hour is too long for a nap. But you can talk to people and go 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and man, you can change who you are and your thought processes and how productive you are and what you can do if you can find a little time in there on that. How are you doing on sleep? I'm going to do something right now I can't even believe I'm going to do. I'm going to use an illustration, and I'm going to do it of somebody I don't like. You've heard in 14 years here, I can't stand the Patriots. I don't like the Patriots. I don't like them at all. And all the time I've been here, they've had the same stinking quarterback the whole time, haven't they? He's old. He's 39 years old, and he's playing his absolute best right now. If you begin to go back and look at videos of Tom Brady when he was 22 years old, they have this video from when he was being recruited for the draft. It was called the Combine, and this video of him running a 40-yard dash in the Combine is legendary for how out of shape he's thought of as the most out of shape guy that ever went in the NFL. So he's at 22 years old, and he begins to describe it. At 22 to 25, he just was living life and just living life and loving it. And he was out of shape, and he realized that he began to love football, and he began to want to be his best for as long as he could be. And people will say, I think there's no debate on this, that he's better at 39 than he was at 24. Can you say that about anybody in a high athletic thing like football? He's getting hit constantly, getting beat up constantly, and he's better at 39 than he was at 24. It's absolutely amazing. Do you want his secrets? Tom Brady goes to bed at 8:30 at night. and he says it, I go to bed at 8:30 at night because I want to get up early. And I want to get up and I want to get about life, and he's hardworking. But he goes to bed at 8:30 because he said, my body needs recovery. I work hard, I have my body breaks down, but sleep provides recovery for me. That's the way God wired us. That sleep gives us recovery. It's not just sleep, but it's rest. Do you know where rest comes from? Rest is actually a gift. There's a couple scriptures that I really want to highlight here today. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 is the first one. I want you to notice this. Come to me, Jesus says, all you who are weary and burdened. Is there anybody in here like, that fits me? I'm weary. I'm burdened. And he says, come to me, and I will give you rest. Now, this is not just an isolated part in Scripture. This is found, here's another one. If you go back to Exodus 33:14, the Lord replied, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Have you ever asked God for anything? You ever prayed? Have you ever asked him for rest? I think we need to do that. We need to say, you know what? If you go to bed and try to rest, you can't do it. But if you go to bed and say, God, you are the giver of rest. Make this part of your routine as you get quiet. God, I'm going to come into your presence. I want you to see the verse, Exodus 33:14. Let's put it right up. My presence will go with you. The staying in the presence of God is incredibly important to providing rest for us. Now, if we go to bed and begin to think about all of the things that could happen to us that are bad, if we go to bed and we think about all of the things, all the people that we're mad about from today, we're not in God's presence. In God's presence is fullness of joy. In God's presence, there's trust. And our goal should be that with a regular routine of going to bed, preparing for bed, and a part of that preparing for bed is not just brushing our teeth, but getting in the presence of God. Getting into a place where we're God, I trust you. God, I love you. And God, I praise you for what you did today. And we get into the presence of God, and as we get into the presence of God, then he will give us rest. If we wake up in the middle of the night, say, God, I'm awake right now. I am going to go into your presence. So every time that we wake up in the middle of the night, make that prayer time, make that praise time, make that getting into God's presence. And when we begin to do that, God will do incredible things with us. Many of you have heard me talk about this, but a key moment in my life was, I don't know exactly where I was at, but I said, God, I not only give you my days, and I want to love you and serve you with all of my days, I want to love you and serve you at night. And I give you my nights as well. Use my nights however you want. If you want to keep me awake so that I can pray, God, begin to do that. If you want to talk to me at night, I give you my nights. God, speak to me in dreams. Give me visions of what you want to accomplish. God, I give you my nights. And when I began to do that, life changed for me. Can I encourage you with that? Like, this is my principle today, is that for our health's sake, not only like the Centers for Disease Control, but saying we need to be in rest. We need to practice rest regularly. Not just days, but during our weeks, as a lifestyle for our very lives. We can get away with it for a few days. We can get away with it for a few weeks. But at some point, it's going to catch up with us, and we're not going to be the best that God's created us to be. Have I said enough? Should we take a nap right now? Would that be good? In fact, have you heard me ever say this, like during church? Like if you need to rest, take a nap. That could be more spiritual than like listening to my message. If you do that every single week, you got a problem, you know? You need to get to bed, you know? You got that. Sometimes the most spiritual thing you can possibly do is take a nap.